Here's a fun way to explain the difference between regular interest and compounded interest. Imagine lending someone $1 at the time Christ was born, at let's say 6% interest. Ready? Go! To every Jesus Christ is right. This is especially scary when you consider that all credit cards, loans, and mortgages are all to be paid back with compounded interest. By the way, if you translate the word mortgage to its original language, French, it literally means death pledge, because people will often work their whole lives to pay off their home by the time the banks have made all their money. Interestingly enough, the French Canadians use a different word for mortgage called hypothèque, probably because no one in their right mind would sign up for something called a death pledge. Could you imagine? So coming back to our analogy on compounded interest, you can probably see why Jesus threw the bankers out of the temple in the New Testament. And look what ended up happening to him. It's interesting how the operation of banks in Canada are all textbook examples of fraud, counterfeit, and theft.
There was no fraud. People should have known. But there really is a problem. And that is that the people who knew didn't stop it.
Now, if I did what these private banks do on a daily basis, I would end up here. Here. Or maybe here. So how come the banks can break the law, but no one else can? Well, it's technically not breaking the law when our elected officials create bogus legislation like what's contained in the Bank Act. It says that banks can lend out as much money as they want without having to have a single dollar. In 1991, there was legislation passed in the Bank Act that stated that reserve requirements for banks is completely nil. They don't need to have a dollar in their vaults to actually issue out money.
I don't know if I could agree with you on that.
Well, maybe you'll agree with the office of Jim Flaherty when they say there is no statutory reserve for banks in Canada.
And not that they don't have no reserves, because they do, but according to the bank...
Can I just take this?
Yeah.
Sean Gray? Yeah, go ahead.
I had read that somewhere in the Bank Act of Canada that it was allowed that somewhere between 1990 and 1991 that reserve requirements for banks would be phased out in the next few months.
I tightened them up.
So they have returned to...
I tightened them up. They were eased up, conservatives eased them up in 90 or 91.
Yeah.
And I tightened them up in 95.
So what did you make them... What they are now.
It's roughly 7 to 1.
Roughly 7 to 1.
But I want to go back to the main question.
Maybe he means he tightened it up so much that it slipped right through his fingers back into legislation. Because although there are other complex regulations that banks still have to meet, our government has given private companies the authority to break the law, which in turn is bankrupting the people and the government itself. And then when our government decides to so-called fix the mess that they created, They simply make cuts to all the programs that we'd like to spend our tax dollars on, and instead direct it towards an inescapable debt.
Anyway, I decided I'm going to get my $5, so I got to go in the bank, right? Which is, it's hard, because they're open for like 10 seconds, they're like, ah, and they close, they're never open. But I go in. I get to a teller and I say, I want my $5. So she looks me up and says, you don't have $5. And what happens? She says, we charge you another 15 for only having 5. So now, you know how much I have? I have negative 10. Negative 10, that means I don't even have no money. I wish I had nothing, but I don't not have any money. I don't have it. I can't afford something that doesn't cost anything. I can't afford it. If somebody goes, hey, it's free, take it. I can't afford that. That costs nothing. That's more than I need 10 bucks to be broke.
So on a daily basis, how much exactly are we spending on this pointless debt?
Like 100,000, maybe more than that.
We spend $160 million every day.
Are you serious? Oh my god.
Yeah.
That's right. According to Statistics Canada, both federal and provincial debt combined, we're paying $160 million each and every day, or $60 billion every year. Let's put all this into perspective. The largest counterfeiters in Canada produced $3.5 million and were sentenced to 5 years in prison. The largest bank robberies in Canada, committed by the Stopwatch Gang, stole about $15 million and got 16 years in prison. As a result of borrowing from private banks, $160 million goes missing every day, and no one even gets fired.
So what you're saying is pretty much the banks that are in Canada that are chartered by Parliament
chartered
and all that,
yep.
By Parliament,
yep.
Are pretty much just robbing the Canadian government and in turn the Canadian citizens, because they're causing us to have a higher tax rate than required.
Yeah, exactly,
you know, just to dig into their pockets and get themselves a little
right.
bit richer.
So what could you do with $160 million every day?
Oh my god. What I would do, I would pay off my school, I would pay off my parents' mortgage. Like, holy, I'd go on like 10 trips.
Let's start out with $160 million for a lifetime. Never mind a day, buddy, because right. I'd be in a forever party.
Well, actually, no idea. $160 million? Like, that's so much money. I wouldn't even know what to do with it.
You'd become pretty selfish, I think, right? You'd be self-centered, that's for sure, because you wouldn't have anything to care about.
If you really wanted to, you could buy the Maple Leafs franchise just after a few days and still have millions left over to party with. Probably to try and forget that you bought the Leafs franchise. Or you could buy enough beer to keep the whole country wasted 24/7. I think we'd get a lot of votes for that.
I got an idea. How about as an incentive to pay off the debt, we start stacking the payments with $100 bills and create a new national monument. Think about it.
The CN Tower stands about a quarter mile high. If we stacked our debt using $100 bills, we could create the first ever money tower, totaling 540 miles high. That would dwarf the CN Tower, and it may help with our space exploration. Talk about a tourist attraction. But let's not get over our heads. First things first, we have to change this picture. Because federal and provincial debt combined, we still owe about $800 billion. Plus, every time we make those $60 billion payments, a good chunk of that goes to compounded interest alone. In other words, when we make these $60 billion payments, we may only see about $50 billion taken off. And when you think about how we've already spent about $1.5 trillion over the years on a debt that we still have, any new debt our government gets us into turns into that number times much more. I know some of you may be asking, why on earth would the government keep digging themselves a hole of debt to get out of debt? Well, obviously you don't come from Canada.